for Sunday morning service. If I may invite you to have a seat, that would be great. We also want to invite Spender joining us live stream. So just wait here. So here's our call to worship from Psalm 24, 7 to 10, which reads, "Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come." Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates, lift up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. I may invite you to stand, please.
For our sins, sorry, I pronounced the word wrong, but it means that somebody that's taking on punishment for somebody else's sin.
To a
Okay, you may have a seat. It is the last Sunday in memory verse. So this month, the memory verse is from Colossians 1, verses 15 to 19. And if I can invite those who are practicing it for the month to stand up and say the memory verse. We have no takers today.
Goodness and your mercies towards us. We thank you that
You are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and you alone are worthy of our praise and adoration. Lord, it has been a long week, and we pray that you will now help us to direct our hearts and our minds to you so that times of refreshing may come. We thank you, Father, that your eyes are towards the righteous and that you're close to the brokenhearted. And we think of those that were affected by the shooting in Texas, those young children. And we pray this morning that you will be a God of comfort to the family, to those victims, those young ones that were so innocently taken away from us. God, we pray that you will make yourself real to them and to us. There's so much things that are happening around the world, Father God, and we just pray that you will just help us to just draw closer to you, now more so than ever before. We think of Pastor Bell, who's away in Malawi, and we pray that you will be with him and that you will give him strength as he ministers to the people of Malawi. Lord God, that the time will be good for him, will be good for the people of Malawi, and that you will be glorified through it all. Father, we thank you and we praise you, and we ask, Lord God, that as we now direct our attention to the preaching of your word, that you will bless the preaching of your word. We pray that you will forgive us, Father God, for our sins. Forgive us for the times that we have drifted from you this past week. And we pray that you will create in us clean hearts and purify us, Lord God, so that we may worship you and that we will receive from you what you have in store for us this morning. Lord God, we pray that you will just bless us this morning, and as we leave here today, that we will say it was good for us to leave this morning. Thank you for who you are. Thank you again for our time together this morning. Bless us as we look to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So this morning, as I mentioned, Pastor Bell is away, and so we do have a guest speaker who is Terry Laidlaw. So Terry is a fourth-generation dairy farmer. He serves as an associate pastor at Maple Avenue Baptist Church in Georgetown. Terry has been involved in full-time ministry since 2006, focusing primarily on youth and seniors ministry. Terry and his wife, Barb, who's here with us this morning as well, have four sons, Tim, Matt, Peter, and Seth. So please join me in welcoming Terry to the podium.
Thanks, Rand. That dairy farming part of it ceased a year ago from yesterday. It was our sons for five generations that's on our farm, and they were hosting cattle for 150 years plus, and that came to an end. We were squeezed out of it by the city of Brampton. That's what happened. It's great to be with you. We're united in Christ, aren't we? And to come and open up the Word together. Just a couple of ties to our church. We've had Ken and Heather Bell in our church for a season. Years back, where I had a long ministry here. And of course, we love them. And we actually have the Lebensdale girls coming, part of our church, which is part of this ongoing ministry. And then at a recent wedding, Hassan and I happened to be at the same table. Barb and I and Hassan. And we didn't make any vows that day, but yet here I am, helping him out. It was at Victor Arkin's wedding, and it was great to get to know Hassan that day a little better. And so for a few weeks here, our church and your church, we're connected, aren't we? Just kind of sharing the gospel together. So we're on bed from 11:33 in the 12:2. We're going to be focusing mostly on Romans 12, verses 1 and 2 today. So for a lot of us, we look back on our time of education, elementary school, middle school, high school, and possibly college and university, masters, PhDs, whatever. It just seems to be ongoing, doesn't it, Paul? Continuous education. And that's really what we have here in the first 11 chapters of Romans. Paul has taken us to school. We're in a theological classroom that is par excellence and something that we're always in, we're always learning, aren't we? This beautiful, rich theology of the gospel of Christ. And I'm focusing today on just how much God loves us and how we can love Him back. So a little bit I'd like to call the classroom we've been in, or the school, Agape Academy, the Love Academy, or possibly we're getting our Master's in Mercy. And that's where we're here in such a rich section of Scripture. And we have an amazing teacher, don't we? We have the Holy Spirit. God is our teacher. And that's what we read in verse 33. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. So to have the teacher of God Himself, and oh, the depth of His wisdom and the depth of the knowledge He brings to bear into our lives. And the syllabus, as they say, is Romans chapters 1 through 11. And I like to think of that last part as a valedictory. We've just finished going through all this theology, and then He finishes up by saying, who has known the mind of the Lord? Who has been His counselor? Who has given a gift to Him that He should be repaid? For from Him and through Him are all things. And then after the valedictory, the whole class gave up in this great doxology. To Him be glory forever and ever. Amen. So the one exam question after we have studied Romans 1 to 11 is, according to the appeal by the mercies of God, we would ask each other, well, what are the mercies of God? Tell me about His mercy. And so we might look back at Romans and say that we're all under sin. As we are told this morning, Jesus came to take our sin upon Himself, to be the propitiation for our sins. He took the wrath of God that set us free. And having been justified freely by His grace, we're forgiven of our sin, we have redemption through Christ. And now because He's taken our sin, there's no condemnation upon us, is it? No condemnation coming our way. He took that condemnation. And now He says He freely has brought us into the family of God by adoption. So now we're not a spirit of bondage anymore, but a spirit of adoption that we cry out, Abba, Father. So this beautiful, rich mercy of God, that one man's sin and disobedience brought death, but one man's obedience brought life and an eternal life to us. So this is the glorious mercy of God. I love that old song we sing, I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. So our continued education, 1 to 11, is really important. And then it leads us into this appeal in Romans chapter 12. We start at verse 1. There's a similar pattern in Ephesians. In the first three chapters, Paul gives some specific doctrine, and then he ends, now to Him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above what we can ask or think, to Him be glory. Doctrine, doxology, and then into the practice of our faith. And that's what we have here similarly in Romans. And who's this appeal to? I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters. Down in verse 3, by the grace of God, I say to everyone who is among you. So this appeal is a broad appeal to all of us, brothers and sisters in Christ. And Paul sets a pattern how to respond to the mercies of God. He says in 1 Timothy, though formerly I was a blasphemer, chapter 1, verse 13, a persecutor, an insolent opponent, but he says, but I receive mercy. So this appeal on the mercies of God, we're focusing on His mercy. I acted ignorantly in unbelief, and the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. So Paul knew the mercy of God. Here he was in an opponent and a blasphemer, but now I receive mercy. And as I say, chapter 1 to 11 telling us how rich that mercy is and how much God has done for us. And then he says in chapter 1 of Romans, so now what am I to do? I'm set apart to that gospel. I am under obligation to preach the gospel and set apart to God. He says in Corinthians, we're looking at this living sacrifice in the second year. He said, we're always delivered over to death. For Jesus' sake, that the light of Jesus might be manifested in us. So here's Paul's heart for the gospel, always being given over to the ministry of the gospel. So the testimony of Scripture, really strong. Paul's testimony of God's mercy, really valuable for us, is that he's the chief of sinners. What about our testimony? For me, Barbara and I were married in a liberal church 36 years ago. And at that time, I had a self-righteousness and a morality that I thought was okay. Attending church, things like that. I raised up in the church. It was a rural church. But eventually, sin took hold of me. And it was a season of sexual immorality. A pregnancy occurred. She wanted to get an abortion, and she did. And I actually just completely felt hurt. Here's a church-going person with his own righteousness brought down to just in anxiety and sin. And what could I do but cry out? And what did God answer me about, Terry? I've come to grant mercy to you. So think about what your own personal testimony might be, and people need to hear about the mercies of God. I will sing of these mercies of the Lord forever. It should involve our own testimony. We have Paul's testimony. We have our testimony. The people need to hear how amazing this redemption is. It is in Christ, the forgiveness of our sin. So we're going to look now at what Paul's appeal is bringing about. There's three imperatives. So I went to the University of Guelph, and it was mostly classroom stuff. And it was a four-year program in agriculture. And my brother went a little bit later, and he took a two-year program. And you know what he did the first week? He said, let's go out to the farms and see what's going on. Swine farms, dairy farms, beef farms, and they were out there right where the action was happening. And a little bit I'm thinking now in chapter 12 and on in Romans is we're going on a field trip. We're going to get our boots dirty. And this is still the classroom, but it's practical. We're going to find out exactly what this Christian life looks like in light of this great mercy of God. So imperative number one, I'm calling loving God. First of all, I should have said earlier, God loves us through his mercy. And now, loving God is the first imperative to present your bodies as a living sacrifice to God. Jesus would say, greater love is no one than this, and he laid down his life for his friends. And he says, you are my friends if you do whatever I command you. So here's a command, and here's loving Jesus by showing obedience. I love when Paul writes in Ephesians 5, imitate me as dear children, imitate Christ, and walk in love as he also has loved us, and given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God, for a sweet-smelling aroma, so that Christ's a pattern of offering himself as a sacrifice. We said, Paul earlier, always delivered over to death for Jesus' sake, and now to each one of us, in this pattern, is to present ourselves to God, a living sacrifice. That presenting of sacrifices rooted in Leviticus in the Old Testament, they kept coming presenting sacrifices to God, but now it's ourselves. Earlier in Romans, he said, do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being raised from the dead, being brought to life, and all of our members as instruments now of righteousness to God. So this is the gospel blessing as well, that this sacrifice is holy and acceptable to God. And how is that? Well, just like Paul set apart in the gospel, we're now saying, Lord, here I am, set apart for you. So that's that holy, sanctified, set apart sacrifice. And how are we accepted by God? We're accepted because Christ has made us accepted in the beloved. He is the one that through him we have the acceptance with God. There's a beautiful benediction in Jude. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, So Christ himself, we're presenting ourselves to him, and one day all of us together will be presented by Christ to God. This church presented without fault. So yes, now we're holy and accepted by God, and one day he will present us as well. Holy before the Lord. We can think of, in this sacrificial way, the parable of the sower. Some of the seed fell on rocky ground, and there wasn't much soil, and it took root and got going, but what when persecution came? What happened? It withered and died. So a little bit, where was the sacrifice called for them when persecution comes? We see that sacrificial spirit to come, and we're set apart in the gospel. And we're committed to doing that. And some of the seed would fall upon a weedy ground where there's thorns and things have come in and choke it out, so cares of this world and riches come and choke it out, so that might stop us from being that sacrifice. The sacrifice needs to come in times of persecution, in times of wealth. The rich young ruler also came to Jesus, and Jesus had said he loved him. Isn't that an awesome thought that God so loved the world he sent Christ, and someone coming to him? Can you imagine coming to the God in whom all things consist, Jesus Christ, Lord of heaven and earth, and coming to him with an amazing question? What must I do to have eternal life? So you come to the right person. You come to this one who knows the future glory, who knows this amazing kingdom that's coming. So Jesus says, I'm calling you to do one thing, to sacrifice. Sell all you have and give it to the poor and come and follow me. So what was his response? He said, he went sorrowful away. He said, for he had great riches. So we're seeing here as well, who's calling us? God. And who set the pattern? Jesus. And now we're to be living sacrifices by Jesus' work, acceptable to God. And that's why it says, this is your logical thing that you should do. This is your spiritual worship. Logikos is a Greek word. This is absolutely logical. The rich young ruler did not do what was logical. He turned away from the one who could show him the way to the kingdom and eternal glory and eternal life. So Paul is appealing, in light of this mercy, what Christ has done, now present your bodies to God. Isn't that an awesome thought? Oh, the depth of the riches and knowledge and wisdom of God, that we might actually inherit that. We're the whole realm of nature, mind, that we're present far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands what? My soul, my life, my all. So my last point on this first imperative, which is our loving of God, is we need to be prayerful. Sure, we've heard before to pray on the armor of God. And here we're praying for, say, Lord, take my life. Take my hands, take my feet. In the morning, by prayer, presenting ourselves as a sacrifice to God. Will that not change the course of our day? We're walking in the footsteps of Christ as he has given himself. And now he's set the way for us and follow me. And that we might have the joy of just presenting ourselves as unworthy and weak and frail as we are, that God might use us for his glory. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. He's called us, for from him, through him, and to him are all things. We're his church, we're his people. We are the most beautiful offering, the church serving God. So I'd like to go to imperative number two. Do not love the world. We're loving God, but do not love the world. So don't be conformed to the world. Is it not a day and age in our culture where there is such a profound pull to worldly values? The world is demanding conformity. We see it right in our own nation with Bill C-10. Was brought out, and to censorship and to police the internet. If something doesn't fit in this worldview, this secular view that's taking root in not just Canada, but in many nations, in a bold, blatant way to come and say, this is the way, now conform to it. They won't suffer any opposition. They would like to bring our thoughts into captivity, shape the hearts of the young. And in a sense, we're looking at our freedoms, aren't we? Freedom of speech, freedom of religion. I'm always amazed in the book of Esther that Haman would come through and all the people would honor him and bow down, but Mordecai wouldn't. I say, Haman, was it not enough that a great percentage of people bowed down? Why do you need Mordecai to bow down? And I do think that our culture right now will not suffer anyone in opposition. So this is an extreme challenge for our church to be distinct from the world. So we need to focus on what makes us distinct. My wife went to visit her sister just recently in Kenora, and she is very much rooted in the secular views of our culture. And Barb said when she came home, she just had to kind of somewhat rest in her beliefs, because whenever she said something that seemed to push a little bit against her sister's values, it was immediately met with anger. And a bit of an outburst back, and I think that's a little bit where to be distinct today is not going to be received very well. Just read recently where they don't even want chaplains in the military now to be of Christian background, because we have somewhat a way of looking at things that doesn't embrace the full view of our culture. So Paul would say in Romans 1 that the world is suppressing the truth in unrighteousness. And they become futile in their thinking, their hearts are darkened. Claiming to be wise, they have become fools. Exchanging truth for a lie. So we know who the ruler of the world is. And what Paul is pleading with us, it's an imperative. Do not be conformed to the world. Be distinct from the world. I do have a few quotes. Nancy Piercy wrote a book, Love Thy Body. And she talks a lot about what it was like in Paul's day in Rome. Rome was a very godless and moral culture at the time of this book of Romans, writing this book. She says, for the dominant male in ancient Rome, virtually anyone was fair game without regard to sex or age. Ancient culture thus gives a concrete historical example of social chaos that results when sexuality is untethered from marriage and family. Some of the early martyrs were actually martyred because they refused to serve us in this way when they were called to that debilitating place of just to have power of the Roman male in that day, everyone subjected to me. Christianity, with Paul's message here that was calling the Roman church or people to come, brought value to women, value to marriage, and a strong belief in God's creative plan. So the vain philosophy of the world is all around us. At our church this morning, our youth pastor was teaching in an adult class from a book called Strange New World by Carl Truman. And he's just laying out everything that's happening. And he would say, how thinkers and activists have redefined identity and sparked the sexual revolution. And what unifies this change, he traces it back to philosophers, Descartes and Rousseau and many others, and how everything is pushing to this new notion of self. And this, the key phrase being expressive individualism. The modern self assumes the authority of inner feelings and sees authenticity as defined by the ability to give social expression to our inner feelings, to live out one's own humanity as against surrendering to conformity to religion or a previous generation. Anything imposed from the outside, self is king. Your feelings need to be acted on and expressed. So this is this strange new world, and when you take that to its logical conclusion, just whatever type of expression you have in life, in sexuality, or that is, it comes from the inside and it needs to be expressed. And that's the importance, this centrality of self. So we do have this, again, strange new world is telling us about how philosophy has changed and taken root in our culture. And it's a powerful movement with self at the center, but don't be conformed to that. And as well, I was thinking about just even our church doctrine being watered down by the world. I was reading J.I. Packer recently, and in this book, Knowing God, which is a long time popular book, he says, to an age that unabashedly sold itself to the gods of greed, pride, sex, and self-will, the church mumbles on about God's kindness, but says nothing about his judgment. The subject of divine wrath has become taboo in modern society. And Christians, by and large, have accepted this taboo and conditioned themselves never to talk about God's judgment. In Romans 11, just before this chapter 12 that we're in, and Paul says that we need to remember the goodness and severity of God. And Packer would want to say that we have now, we're focusing on his goodness, but not the severity of God. And he says, this Santa Claus theology, that sins create no problem, atonement is needless. And it pretty much just focuses so much on goodness, which leads to a prosperity gospel, doesn't it? But then he says something really interesting, I want to share it with you. He says, well, how do you deal with evil when we're just focusing on this God who's so good? So we might just have to separate God from anything evil, but the cruelty and marital division and all the issues of life that come in that we would say is hard to understand. He said the only way to get around that is we deny God's omnipotence and lordship over the world. So focusing on God's goodness, he said, leads to a fatalistic and pessimistic attitude to life. Hey, there's evil, what can we do with it? So the church needs to focus on the goodness and the severity. Don't we see in Romans chapter 5, God demonstrates his love toward us. And then next verse, he says, we're saved from the wrath of God through Christ. Love and wrath side by side. And we see that in numerous places in the book of Romans. So don't be conformed to the world in our church. Don't let the world squeeze our doctrine into its mold. Let's remain distinct from the world. Jesus said, I do not ask, Father, that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. So Jesus' priestly prayer to God his Father is that God keep them from the evil one. They're not of the world, but they're in the world, and I've sent them. So in these imperatives, don't love the world. And the last imperative, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. I heard one pastor say one time that he wanted to get up into one of those control towers at the airport. And all these, just think of all the planes coming in Toronto. We see them around our farm coming into Brampton, and we kind of get to know the routes a little bit, but somebody's telling them when to go, when to circle around again, take another loop. These things have got a little bit busy at the airport. And he actually did. This was Alistair Begg, and he said he did get into one of those control towers one time just to see this, the way everything in the skies is coming in under one, actually, mind. And he says the control tower, the mind is our control tower. And we, by the renewing of our mind, he says the things in the body will flow from that. So a renewed mind is renewed in the ways of God. And then as we present ourselves a living sacrifice, it actually comes as our mind is guiding our lives. Paul writes in Romans 8, those who walk according to the flesh set their minds to the flesh. But those who walk according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. In the next chapter, which is a continuing love theme, owe no one anything but to love one another, and he says, so put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Make no provision for the flesh. Set our mind where? On things above. What was that new philosophy, this expressive individualism, this inner self that needs to be expressed, not conforming to any religious influence or for previous generations? That's why what previously was accepted in society now is nearly seen like a vice. So we don't want to, we're looking outside of ourselves, we're setting our mind now on things above, and that's where we find life. There's a song sung by Sovereign Grace that says, turn your eyes. To Jesus we lift up our eyes. He's the glory and our prize. Turn your eyes to Jesus. Turn your eyes to the hillside where he's crucified. Turn your eyes to the morning where he's resurrected. Turn your eyes to his glory that's to come to the heavens. So we are renewing our mind is actually turning our eyes completely upon Christ. Keeping our eyes in chapters 1 to 11. But as well, day by day, walking with him. So obedience to these commandments, I've titled this imperative, loving one another. Be transformed. So God has loved us. Living sacrifices, we love God. Don't love the world. And in the renewed mind, we find this beautiful call to love one another. Jesus setting his example for that. So we need to saturate our minds with the Word, with the living Word, and in prayer. And the will of God is mentioned here. As we pray, it says, whatever you pray according to the will of God, God hears us. And what is God's will? That we love one another. God's will that we walk in love. That we set our minds on him. As I have loved you, you should also love one another. So what are you setting your mind on right now in your life? What is being nurtured in your heart? Do you know, my dad's got a little bit older. He's 88. He turned 88 a few days ago. He's got so many opinions on politics and things like that. He just comes over, Barbara and I have him for supper, and we just could sit down and just listen to him for now. Because he just has all this stuff. As you get older, what's in your mind? What's going to be coming out in that old age? My wife and I talked about when we get a bit of dementia maybe later on. What's going to be coming out of our mouths? And a little bit, I think, is what we set our mind on through our lives. If by the Spirit of God we put to death sin, and also now put on Christ, what is in our mind when it comes to, let's just say the mind is going to be opened up in older age. It was similar to Alistair, when I was talking about Alistair Begg recently, he said he was driving with a conservative pastor friend, and he asked him, what's your greatest fear or a prayer that you might give? He says, I pray to the Lord that I will become a dirty old man. And Alistair said he had to sit and think about that, but where are we setting our lives on? Are we really kind of rooted in the flesh so much that as we get older, that's what's getting expressed? I pray to the Lord that when I get older, my heart might be so enamored with you and so focused on you that what comes out of my mouth and that what my hands are still doing is going to be loving one another. Let no corrupt language come out of your mouth, that we might reign in our speech, reign in our thoughts, reign in the flesh. That right now, owe no one anything but to love one another. The love fulfills the law. That's chapter 13. So there's two ways to be transformed, by renewing of your mind, and lastly now, by testing. You might discern what is the will of God. We talked about an earlier test, didn't we? Describe the mercies of God after that beautiful classroom of doctrine. And now here's a test in this practical Christianity. Test by discernment to see how your heart is. What love is being expressed in your heart. Discerning what is of God and what's not of God. What pleases him. What brings him glory. It was just last Monday, the holiday Monday, that I woke up and there was no water to brush my teeth. And then I realized there was no water anywhere in the house. So my mind went, I thought, uh-oh, I better open that basement floor, basement door. And I looked down there, there was that much water in the basement. And we're on city of Brandon water, and it was coming out like a fire hose, and there was no shut off, it was just filling our basement. So we made some frantic calls. I started trying sticking a finger in that hole, or a broom handle, and I mean, it was just crazy, the pressure. But after that, Barb and I were cleaning up. Barb was emotional, and my wife, there were some things about our boys, some memories here. And I love it when Paul says to Timothy, warn the rich to be rich toward God, that they might find out what is truly life. So as we were looking through our basement, it kind of revealed what is life right now to us. Is it in these memories when our boys were small, or all these type of things, or is it something different, something that a flood can't touch? So I would like to encourage you to think of that by discernment, by testing. Now, it's a test for Barbara. Where is our heart? What's life for us? And it was a good thing to do, to go through. Our life is what? Hid with Christ, isn't it? When Christ, who is our life, appears, we shall appear with him in glory. Like that rich young ruler, why would he turn away from the one that is, oh, the depth of the riches of Christ? Here, come, follow me. The one who's Lord of heaven and earth. So this testing happens in community. We need to care for one another in this. As we love one another, we're encouraging each other how to love. I was in a core prayer group recently. Our church does that. We put four people together and we pray for one another on a certain Christian virtue that you feel weak in. Okay, so you commit to, let's say, 2 months of praying every day for that brother. One brother said, pray for patience of my marriage, patience with my children. Another brother said, I need to love my co-workers better. He works at Chrysler. I need to grow in love. Another brother said, I'm not doing well. I'm not doing the word. My brother and I are fighting, and there's issues I had within my family. And then one brother said, I just want to be worshiping God at all times. And it just felt like that was the umbrella over everything. And that's Romans 12. This is your spiritual worship. That we might be living sacrifices to God. And actually next week, my son is coming and he's going to finish this chapter in how the threads of this obedience about living sacrifices and renewing of your mind flows into all of relationships. Humility, don't be wise in your opinion. Associate with the lowly. And worship God to be constant in prayer, administering the needs of the saints, how this is our logical worship. So when that brother said worship, I thought, what a joy to think of worshiping God at every moment. You'll be ready to give that testimony of his mercy. Your hands will be ready to meet the need of someone that you meet during that day. So in this Agape Academy, we are called to go out into the field and love one another. Love our neighbor. And that's the love of God flowing through us. So Romans, I appeal to you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to do what? Verse 9, let love be genuine. He said to the Ephesians, I urge you now to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, but bearing with one another in love. So they appeal to the Ephesians to come, present yourself, walk worthy in love. To Timothy, he said, the aim of our charge is love, that issues from a pure heart, from a sincere faith, and from a good conscience. So that's why I call this a love chapter in Romans, that we're called to love one another, and the aim of our charge is love. I'm going to close with this verse from Psalm 91. Because he holds fast to me in love, here's a promise from God. I will deliver him, I will protect him, because he knows my name. When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him with long life. I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, where would we turn but to you? Christ has come to show us the way of abundant life. So Lord, we lay hold of the word of God today, the bread of life. We lay hold of Christ, who is for us the way, the truth, and the life. And we know he's come to share the love of God, to present himself as a living sacrifice. So Lord, may we show our love back to you by doing the same, presenting ourselves to you, and loving one another to discern that your will is, it's good that we love. It's acceptable for eternity, things rooted in the love of God. This is your will, is it not, Father, that we might find joy and the thrill in living the Christian life of loving one another. In Christ's name we pray.
Amen. Please stand. Thank
you.
have a seat. Thank you for that, Mr. Terry. All right, so just a few announcements. Minister Leader, so our annual meeting is coming up, so if you can please, reports are due on Sunday, June the 5th. You can either email them or drop them off at the church office, that would be great. Tonight, adult Sunday school at Zoom, 6:30. Prayer meeting this week is Wednesday at 7 p.m. Also, for this week, the Tuesday Bible study will be starting back up. That will be on Zoom, right, Mr. Chen?
Yeah.
7 p.m. on Zoom, all right? And in your bulletin this morning, there is a slip. So members who are willing to be placed on the list to pray when an urgent need arise, fill that in and drop it off into the offering plate. That will be great. Also, church cleanup will be happening on June the 11th. If you can just come out for that. Normally it's like 9 to 12. Many hands make that work, right? So we'll be happy whether it is, if we can schedule some time in our busy schedule to come and help us, that would be great. And finally, just wanted to give a big shout out to the church on behalf of the board. Thank you very much in regards to your response to the blankets from Malawi. We were able to raise what was needed, so thank you for that. Much appreciated. And if you can just stand for the benediction,
love coming to support us on today and to meet you all. Sounds like there's some good work going on through your church. So a benediction from Romans. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor things present, things to come, nor any created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Amen.